expect Anthony Holmes turning up, you know, with no stone unturned, and the best version of Anthony Holmes that you're going to see, whether it be a war or whether Anthony Holmes, you know, puts on a masterclass. So I'm not going any further than that. But you'll see the numero uno, the king of the bare knuckle that night, won't you? So many people, just like lads off estate who got involved in certain stuff, drinking, whatever, and just can't find a way out now, but there is a way out. It don't matter whether you fight a white collar or an unlicensed boxing fight, or you're fighting 12 rounds, it is fucking hard, mate. As soon as you put your foot through them ropes, It is hard. And I say it to people all the time. If I could get a capsule and sell you it, of that feeling of getting your hand raised, of being in a boxing ring, I'd be a multi-millionaire. But until I were honest to myself and not in denial about what I were doing to myself and doing to people around me, then I couldn't fucking move forward. And one day I'm just like, what I do it now, I'm gonna lose everything. But everything I'm not made me everything I am. Damn. Here we go again. People talk the shit, but when the shit hit the fan. When Kiko Martinez fought Josh Warrington, they come over to support him and they use my gym. So just repaid favour, really. Went over and Kobe Spad, Spanish champion, and Michael Vivera Spad, another kid like. So went out, bit of sightseeing and that. Obviously, I'm off at Gage, yeah. So just had a mooch, really. And just it's good for lads to feel out of the comfort zone, especially in different cities, sparring their champions, you know what I mean? So just...
How does that build up for the sparring for people who are like sort of not in the in that community? Do you just show up, spar? And
well, because I knew the kid, the lad were like a couple of times. Kobe Spad, the owner of the gym, he's like a big name over there. I think he went challenged for a world title and then he lost that and he retired, but always keep in touch with him, you know what I mean? Just went over and just they did the thing. My lads spar the best up and down the country, so to them it's just another day in office. It's a little bit warmer.
How are those boys faring? Are they out soon? You've got Kobe, you've got Fafera.
So it's a big day for Jimmy's that day, mate. We've got Michael Fafera and Kobe, who are both undefeated, fighting at Magna Centre in Rotherham on Ryan Rhodes' show. And then straight away, I've asked promoter to put them early, 190 miler straight down motorway for...
How much pressure's on you there? Is it a lot of stress on coach there to be fucking back and forth? Or?
It's a fucking stressful day because 3 wins, 3 knockouts would be nice, wouldn't it, on paper? But I've made sure that everything's put in place early, that they finish their fights, and I'm in good time and good stead for when it's time to rock and roll for Holmesy. In that time period there, Holmesy will just be chilling. He'll be just, he does his thing, doesn't he?
Oh, is that same day?
Same day.
Yeah, mate, same day.
Busy day.
Busy day, but it could be one of the best days on paper for Jim, you know what I mean? So it inspires me.
What, shoot us a little promo, we've been asking everyone. April 22nd, you've got your fighters there, but Anthony Holmes, Danny Christie.
Yeah.
Give us a little bit of insight without any game plan giving away, obviously, of what do you expect, how's camp been? Is everyone going to be ready for it?
Yeah, Holmes is... there's been no stone unturned, that's a matter of fact. The last fight was me and Holmesy gelling as a chain of fighter companionship, me understanding Holmesy, how he works. And after that, I could put a full camp together, understanding the situation, when he spars, what's the best day to spar, you know, the right sparring partners for Danny Christie, the right days to train pads, bags, you know, conditioning and stuff like that. And then obviously he does a day with Wayne and they do their thing. And between us, you know, we've got a real, real good thing going. So, you know, on the night when the fight, it's time to go, you know, everything's bang on the button in place.
As a coach, do you study a lot of tape? Is that a big part of your
system? Definitely. Basically, I expect, like, people think, oh, you go to the gym, you train the fighter, you know, you go home, you get your nugget down and that's it. You spend countless hours looking at, you know, footage. There ain't loads of footage of Danny Christie's most famous fighters with Dick Eggy, you know what I mean? And that was just a straightener. A bit like bare knuckle, but different in many ways. And he's had a couple of good wins. I've looked at him and technically put in place a game plan that I've put over to Holmesy, and we've together, you know, well, we know it's going to be the right game plan to to get a win on
In terms of tactics, I don't want you to give anything away, but how different is it to coach gloved versus bare knuckle? Is it a different animal, a different sport? Is it a different world?
It's similar in the offensive part of the fight, you know, being offensive and throwing certain combinations and footwork. Defence can be different because you've got no one on your hands, you know, and there's different ways of blocking shots and slipping and moving. Now, if you look at, I've got a lot of experience in training bare knuckle fighters now because obviously, you know, I had Smudger who had about, I think, 4 fights, 3 wins, 1 loss, and it took a fight against Sean George, you know, on a week's notice, that, and on paper that was close. I thought Smudge took that fight. He win a tournament, a prize fight, a final, which he could have won. You know, I've had James Kennelly, Jimmy Sweeney, and I've had other names.
He's still involved, Sweeney, isn't he?
Yeah, he's back on now. Obviously, Barry Jones is a very, very good fighter. And I'm not taking that away from the fight, but like I said, that was my first fight with Jimmy Sweeney, and that wasn't Jimmy Sweeney of old at all, and he will tell you that. But that's by the by. It were a fair win from Barry Jones. But yeah, he's back in the gym and cracking on now. He's fighting in May. I think he got a guy called Johnny Tello. I think he's based in Thailand.
That's the guy that Barry Jones fought in Thailand, isn't
he? He did, mate. Yeah, I think he did a number of him as well. So I think it's a good fight for Sweeney at this time of his career.
I was watching sort of AJ at the weekend, and he keeps moving coaches. Yeah. How important is it to give enough time to the coach to build that bond, to build that sort of brotherhood there,
It's massive. It's massive. Like, for me as a trainer, AJ is getting a lot of criticism now. I did see slight implements in his how he is as a fighter in that fight. You know, sort of instead of going in a straight line, he was sort of changing the line of attack and stuff like that. And I just feel like it's hard to say if he's not lost his bottle to engage. Because of such a big knockout loss against Ruiz, and I were actually at that fight, Madison Square Garden, and he's just head went right in corner. You know, I says to me, mate, I says, he's going to get chinned here. And he got chinned. Not that I'm fucking...
What do you put that down to? Because obviously you get a lot of armchair people saying he's done, he's finished, he should retire. What do you put that down to when he's made that much money? Does that counteract the passion to keep driving?
It's the drive. It's the drive, mate. I mean, would you get up at 5 a.m. and fucking go through when you've got 50 million in bank and a big
titty. Hard to keep motivated, hard to keep.
You know what I mean?
I bet he's got a routine of them and as well, but yeah. Nice rotation.
Morning and night.
I bet he's not shy of it.
Oh, no. No, I think it's just that a drive and just being so comfortable in his life. You know, does he want the Fury fight and stuff? You know, does he want Wilder, both cheeky fights for him? Or does he want that nice leopard skin robe?
He came out yesterday, Ian, saying he wants another sort of tune-up fight and then sort of get him out in summer and then get him out in December.
From AJ's point of view, I that's quite a good idea. For him as a trainer, I think he needs time to gel with his new trainer. It's his last chance, do you know what I mean? But I do think he needs that little bit more quality time and another high-level tune-up.
Yeah.
And then we'll see, you know, it'd be a career-defining fight if people are slagging for the rest of his life, or if he will be a real hero.
Is that a polarising figure? People either love him or hate him, don't they? But yeah, he's always a draw.
Yeah, he's always a draw. He puts bums on seats, as simple as that, and he's making dough, isn't he? But, like, when he first come through from Olympics and stuff, he were God's gift, wasn't he? As soon as you get beat, mate, boom, people, especially armchair ones that have had 5 pints and a fucking twifter.
That annoy you, the fuck, that?
Yeah, because, like, I say it all the time, it don't matter whether you fight a white collar or an unlicensed boxing fight or you're fighting 12 rounds, it is fucking hard, mate. As soon as you put your foot through them ropes, it is hard. And I say it to people all the time. If I could get a capsule and sell you it of that feeling of getting your hand raised, of being in a boxing ring, I'd be a multi-millionaire because it's better than any drug, anything that you... can make you feel super high like that in the world. It's the best feeling in the world. That's why boxers come back or they go on too long. Look at Roy Jones Jr. at weekend.
Honestly, dissect that a little bit for someone who's not been in the ring myself or someone who's watching this who's not. Is it the build up, the adrenaline, the actual event, fighting for your life? What is it?
So you play football. I love football. I'm a big Leeds United fan. There's you and 10 other men on pitch, right? You've got 6, 8, 10, 12 weeks, depending on what level you're fighting at, to train. It's you versus them. Simple as that. So as soon as you step through them ropes, it's one-on-one combat sport. And that is the adrenaline of you having to, you know, get yourself in the best shape you can get yourself in. You know, make sure that you make big sacrifices. And it's like a build-up. And then when the bell's done, it's a massive release. So it's a thing of everything. It's like I remember being a kid and getting on my first poster and fucking running around, and I think my mum went in pub or something. I put this up in pub and fucking hell, I'm on that post. It's everything, you know. I've done it for years. And like,
what age did you start all this year?
13, I was.
You start by amateur boxing?
Thai boxer.
Thai boxing.
Yeah, Thai boxer, so at 13, and then just went from there.
And how did you get into Thai boxing? Were you fighting on the street? Fucking.
No, do you know what? My family are from a family of boxers from Ireland and stuff. Now, believe it or not, my business partner, my trainer, who passed away, Steve, he was living with my dad at the time. They went to school together. And he'd been chucked out for summer. He'd had bin liners out anyway. And he was staying with my dad for whatever he'd done.
Yeah.
All right. And one day I was just doing a bit of boxing. He says, "Oh, come down at gym." So I went down at gym. I'll never forget it. And I went to kids class, probably about 11 maybe then. And I trained in kids class. And he went, "Oh, stay, do adults class." I thought, fuck it, I'm fucked here. So I did adults class. He said, "Train." And he said, "Do a bit of sparring." I didn't know what or doing, do you know what I mean? Anyways, I started sparring, and this lad just tapped me on top of the head, and I fucking fell through ropes, you know what I mean? I was knackered and that, but because I showed out and I wanted to do it, I got out of the ring, and he saw it was 6'8". He tapped me on the shoulder and said, "You're going to be a champion, you." And from that day, I just felt this massive fucking bit of self-belief that I could become a champion, and I did. So that's how it started.
What sort of timeline there, then? One question I have got, how do we correctly pronounce your first name?
Padraic.
Yeah.
Padraic. So it's spelt Padraic, pronounced Padraic.
Yeah.
Everyone calls
you P.
Everyone calls me P. Yeah. I fucking went bowling in Thailand once, right? I spelt my name out and it come up on screen, Padraic. You know, you all go to bowl. Fucking Padraic. Looking round for Padraic.
Yeah, it's obviously Irish descent.
Yeah, Irish descent, yeah.
When did you make the transition from fighter to coach then?
Well, I started coaching at quite a young age. I helped Steve with kids' classes, with pads and stuff. And then at 16, I had my first fighter, Thai boxer. And he ended up going 4-0. And then he ended up moving to Australia. But then I had a numerous amount of Thai boxers. And when Steve passed away from there, I've had Northern Area, English, British, Commonwealth, European, a junior world champion and a gold medal in Latvian Baltic Championships. I've had 52 champions. In the meantime of that, I was slowly processing over to professional boxing. I was trained on licensed boxers. Then I started training Jack Bateson. And a lot of trainers can hold pad. Being a trainer ain't all about pad work. You can have silky pad skills and put it on Instagram or whatever, and it looked good, but there's a full surroundings of being a trainer and what you have to do. But then I started working with Jack Bateson, you know, and Jack's won an English and a WBA Intercontinental. He's just coming off a defeat, which he'll be back tenfold and definitely be a champion again.
Has that motivated him?
It's motivated him, mate. And in the meantime, Tyrone Nurse came to me from Huddersfield, and he was the current British champion at the time. And then I was with Tyrone for a couple of fights, and he got offered a Commonwealth title eliminator in Australia. So I went to Australia, and I'm not joking you. You know when they say you need a knockout for a draw? Oh, he chinned the kid for 12 rounds. And even the corner, you could hear the corners saying, the commentators going, he needs to knock him out to win this fight. Anyway, they give kid other decision. It was scandalous. It's on YouTube somewhere. They even offered Tyrone an holiday because they were that embarrassed by the event. But then from there, you know, I've had lads come from up and down the country all over. At this moment in time, I've got Kobe, who's 4-0, who just fought on Josh Warrington's undercard. Did like 700 tickets, big ticket seller. I've got Michael Favera from York, who travels with me from York. He's 7-0, super middleweight now. You know, we've got some really, really good lads, but we've got a gym full of professional boxers now because we have Keith Walton and Justin Newell. You know, all lads are managed by Mark Bateson as well. We've got a real good tight-knit setup, and he's got Ishmael Davies, who's undefeated, Zahid, who's just become English champion. And they've just got a really, really, really good, strong, solid team beside us. And then the other side's the bare knuckle.
How important is it to have that stable of fighters? Because we've got friends who some of it sort of are independent, do it themselves. Some are part of a team. What's the difference?
These guys that do it independently, they get found out. Because you can't, with my experience and my knowledge, if I were ever to fight again, would I as fuck be able to train myself for a fight? Do you know what I mean? You've got to have someone who is standing over you, who's a higher power, who can study the opponent, put structure in place, look after you. Do you know what I mean? Like, baby, really. Do you know what I mean? I just don't think it works when you go independent. It's just not effective at all for me.
From a personal standpoint, we'll dig into your story a little bit. How hard has it been being self-employed and a business owner? Has there been ups and downs? How do you focus and structure that?
It's been rough, mate, because I was 21 and I'm 34 next when my mate died. He died in front of me. We were training at gym. And from there, I had to run a gym on my own at that age. And my head wasn't in a good place. And I were like trying to train fighters, run a business. Then I were moving from one gym to another gym because I couldn't cope of this bloke I'd been with every day since I was 13. Do you know what I mean? And I would try to move from one place to another place and try to run a business, run a gym, look after myself. It's been hard, mate. There's been massive, massive downs where I've been. It's been tough. But the thing is, with me, I don't know how else. I train stand-up fighters, combat sports, professional boxers, Thai boxers, bare knuckle. This is all I know. Do you know what I mean? So I'm very proud of what I've done, but I've had to do it because it's what I am. Do you know what I mean?
Focusing on future a little bit there, like, what is the... Do you have an end goal with it? Is it a continuous sort of cycle?
Of course. Like, for me as a trainer, I want to be remembered as a great, you know? Like, you wear the likes of, like, Freddie Roach, and, you know, you've got big, massive names. Like in England, people talk about Joe Gallagher and, you know, big names. That's what I want. But as a gym, Golden Team Gym, I want it as a gym where it's all family orientated. Do you know what I mean? You've been to my gym. As soon as you walk in, you're made to feel welcome. There's no egos, just hard work, you know. And you can come to the gym. 5% of the people at my gym will train to fight. You know, the other come down to socialise, they like training the Golden Team, they like keeping fit. They just like being in a family-orientated place where there's no hard men or stuff like that. It's just somewhere you can come and feel comfort when you're training.
Back to what you just said then about you don't know anything else, it's all you've ever done.
Yeah.
I know you said just then at the start you're off the gauge, you're not drinking.
Yeah.
How was that? Has that improved your coaching in your life dramatically, stopping that?
Huge. It's huge. Like, my life's totally, totally different without it. Like, what I'm getting done in, it's coming up 3 months, is just, it's like a year's worth of work. And what I've improved on myself as a person, but how the gym's gone through the roof and how the fighters are improving is just tenfold, mate. Because it was... You know, it became, for me, recreational drinking and enjoying myself to fucking being a habit, you know what I mean? And did that
creep in, or did it get out of control?
It creeped in to become an everyday occurrence. And I had to go to rehab. And I spent a month in Oasis in Bradford. And when I first got there, it were like, fucking, I can't do this. Do you know what I mean? Like being at Nick. In fact, there were a guy in there that were locked up with Bronson, and he were in for whatever reasons he were in for. And he said it were easier in there because the structure was solidified. You had to do and be where you had to be. And I'm my own boss. I do what I want when I want. But I realise now that I have to have structure in my life. Like, if I had to put this podcast in today and missed it, my head would have gone west because I know what I've got to do in a day to keep structure and keep focused on what I'm doing. But it's like stuff like now, like, get up in the morning, I'll do gratitude and write things down I'm grateful for, I'll meditate, and I'll do I'll do, keep me training up. Training's a big part, you know, I have to train and feel good. But I'm just getting so much more done, and my life, my relationship is just gone through the roof, mate.
Dig a little bit deep into it then. So you show up to the, what the place called, Oasis?
Oasis, yeah.
And when you say it's like a bit like a jail, you literally staying there 24/7?
Yeah, so I was there for a month, and you sort of, they're coming and take you to a room and stuff, and then it's like a single bed and a little shitty shower and that. And then it's just like you get up and you've got to do these certain things on certain days. But what were hard for me in there was I had gaps through the day where there were not going on, and I didn't know what to fucking do with myself, because I'm always here, everywhere, Jack the Lad, boom, training fighters or fucking about and having a crack with lads or whatever. And that made me realise that I had to find comfort in my own free space, and it wasn't about in that free time going for a drink. And, you know, I've suffered quite a bit of grief. My grandma died in May, and I love my mum. I'm close to my mum and my dad, my whole family. But I lived with my grandma. In Irish, you call her my mo. And I can't blame it on that, because I always had a problem with it. But then I had a massive dip since, I think, in my brain subconsciously. But in there, you know, there were people coming in which I enjoyed, telling us about their lives. And there's so many people, just like lads off estate who got involved in certain stuff, drink and whatever, and just can't find a way out now, but there is a way out.
When you say there that you struggled to be by yourself, was that because you had to address what was going on in your life, or you just, did you find downtown difficult? Just why is that downtime so hard?
It's because of I have a racing mind, because my life's so fast. My life's so fast. Like, for example, this week, you know, I'll take private lessons from 9 o'clock, then there's classes on a night, then I've got to go home and study 3 different fighters that are fighting in April, then I've got a show coming up in May where I've got a match make, then I've got Kobe and Favera sparring someone else in Sheffield, Sunday I've got Anthony Holmes sparring someone in Blackpool, you know, and it's just like a whirlwind. And then my fun and relaxation, chill out time where I had it on my
chill,
own.
Chill, have a beer, do whatever.
Well, not just having a drink, but getting blottoed. Do you know what I mean?
And you were doing that every night?
Most nights, 5 nights a week, I'd say.
And what did it start to affect your business? Is that why you
Well,
made
it just
the jump?
It just started to affect me all life. Do you know what I mean? I was stick thin, built like a Rizzler. I fucking, you know, my relationship, me, I could see my mum worrying, and Claire, who's looked after my gym, who manages my gym, and I've had a lot of good people around me. Until now, I didn't realise how bad I was.
You know, because you're such a big personality, do you think people there are a little bit fearful to address it?
Yeah. Yeah.
Who were the person who said, right, I've got to do something about this now?
It was my missus, my mum and dad, and Claire, who manages my gym, because they know me more than anyone. Like, I was sort of hiding. And I've got, you know, friends, Stu, Mara, lads that were around me. I could mention loads that could see a slippery slope, but didn't want to probably hurt my feelings by saying it. But until I were honest with myself and not in denial about what I were doing to myself and doing to people around me, then I couldn't fucking move forward. And one day I was just like, I've got to do it now, or I'm going to lose everything.
Had it already been brought up to you by these people, and then you'd kind of played on the idea, or did they just have the conversation and then you went, you know what, you're right?
It's been brought up for years with my family and like my missus, and I would just thought they were getting on my back. I genuinely thought they were getting on my back, but the one that were genuinely trying to help me. But because you become, I'm not a selfish person. Like, I love everyone, I'll do out for anyone. But what I was doing there, I was being the most selfish person on this fucking planet.
It is a self-destructor almost a little bit, isn't it?
Massive. It would just, could write a fucking book.
You know, some of the principles there you were talking about, journal and gratitude in the morning.
Yep.
Was that taught inside, or was that something you just picked up through friends?
It was taught inside. Yeah, I started doing it inside and it's something I've carried on, and certain things that I've got to do, you know, daily to keep focused. And like, I know that I'm a strong-minded person when I'm fresh like this, because if not, I wouldn't be 2-time British champion. I wouldn't have a gym full of champions. I wouldn't have a gym. So I know I've got it in here, But the drink were taking it away, you know what I mean, and making me weak.
Mm. We had Christy on yesterday, and this the exact same situation, apart from he realised this when he was in jail.
And he
couldn't get access to it, and then it switched in his mind, and he said he just spent a lot of time on his own. He does all the journaling and stuff like that.
Yeah.
And we said to him, I think it were off camera, but we said, oh, are you having a beer after the fight? And he was like, mate, if I touch one beer, I might as well just give me missus everything, because I'm blood my life. I'm just fucked my life up.
Well, what they say, honestly, mate, it's such a cliche, but as soon as you have what I learned in there, as soon as you have that, people like me and Christy and lads that have come off drinking stuff, is like, there's recreational drinkers that I'd love to be able to go for a glass of wine with my missus and a bit of food and all that, but the way our minds work is once we have that first sip, boom.
Once you pull the pin.
That's the one, mate. It's like a whirlwind.
You're the same, mate.
Yeah,
I can't
touch drink.
You're the same, is that?
I don't mind sharing this. If I just smoke a little bit of weed, that's my advice. Yeah. But in terms of drinking, if I have two, I'm getting a bag. I'm going to fucking make bad decisions. I'm going to be out till fucking 6, 7 in the morning. I just can't control that escalation.
And then you wake up, when you're feeling tender like that, I have to drink again to feel normal. And then it happens again.
What, as in next morning or?
Say, like, for example, I felt tender on a morning. Oh,
you'd be like I'd got a boozer
and it'd start as an errant dog.
And then
it'd become part of time again.
Yeah. Mm. And no good.
And it just fucking leads to no good. No good.
What, you do meditation?
Yeah.
How hard do you find that?
If you two were in here, I feel like I'd twat.
Mate, I know, I do it every day,
he's into meditation.
Every day, yeah.
No, I mean, people think like that, I'm meditating, fucking home.
No.
All I do in the morning is a basic thing. It might last 6 minutes. I'll just lay in bed and I'll listen to it and I'll think of all the good going on in my life. And it's boom, I'm jumping out of bed. I'm looking like Rocky Balboa, shadow boxing.
I ain't got to the jumping out of bed stage yet.
It's good that Danny said the exact same thing yesterday. And the one thing that made me think yesterday, I don't know if...
You felt like shit after he said that. You were like, I jump out of bed every day, like fucking buzzing. And Josh were like, I felt like shit when he said that because I fucking hate getting out of bed.
But that makes you address what I learned yesterday. It makes you address where you're spending your time.
Yeah.
Because to me, if you're excited about life, and you're enthralled, like, right, let's go do this. You are going to wake up with energy because you're moving towards a big mission.
Yeah.
It makes you sometimes be a bit self-critical. Like, how am I spending my time now? Is it worthwhile? Should I be doing these things? It made me yesterday, like, fucking, am I doing the right stuff?
Yeah. It's like, as well, I won't really set myself goals. And now that I've got, like, my goal is to have 3 fights, 3 wins on 22nd of April. Do you know what I mean? And just like, that's my goal now. My focus is to get these lads, when they step on them scales, mate, they're going to have muscles in the fucking piss and they're going to be feared. And everything possible I can do to give them lads the best chance of a win that night, I'm going to do.
We'll change gears a little bit. We had Bakewell on, wasn't it, last week?
Yeah.
And he's discussing BKFC in terms of being... at a stage where UFC were back in the day and turning into a massive organisation.
Yeah.
Do you see that with BKFC? Do you see it being able to compete with something like that?
I do. Yeah, I do. I think it's a good organisation and the names they're getting speaks for itself, mate. It's not just fucking Bill and Ben fighting outside Birdcage, is it? It's proper elite level lads fighting elite level lads. Do you know what I mean? I do. I think it'll be... there or thereabouts.
You think they're doing a good job of moving around the country as well? That's big.
I do. I really do. I think it's good that it's all over the place. And I think it's great that they're giving fighters chances to fight in America on global stages, you know what I mean? Mm. And it's nice to have it in Leeds as well.
Being a Leeds lad, is there any local boys who we should keep an eye out? Is there anyone who's a bit under the radar who's probably a big prospect?
On the bare knuckles scene, you've probably got to look at, like, being a Leeds lad, I'd say Scott McHugh.
Mm.
You know... and Scott's my pal. I trained Scott when he fought Leeson for a British title. And Scott is just game as a badger. And what he lacks in a boxing ability, he makes up for in heart and fire and passion, you know. As a Leeds lad coming through on the bare knuckle scene, I'd probably say Scott McHugh in Leeds, yeah.
We've got a friend of ours, Johnny Graham, fighting on that show.
Johnny Graham, fucking hell, I forgot about Johnny, yeah. Johnny's a good lad, and he can box, and he can fight. He might be one, and you know what? Is Luke Kelly Leeds?
Luke Kelly's Leeds, but he's out at BKB. He's fighting Lawson in May.
Right, okay. But yeah, I'd keep me out for Johnny Graham. Yeah, he's a good kid.
Has he been cool on the radar customer. A little bit as well than Kelly?
Yeah, I think
dangerous man.
I think Kelly bare knuckles a fucking monster, mate. I do.
What path as a coach there? Like what? Not to speak on Luke's behalf. What path should he take? Like what? How do you? I think he's got all the talent in the world, mate.
He could be a high level professional boxer, Luke. I don't overly know Luke too well. He's been down to my gym sparring and I've had good chats with him. I think what I've got from Luke is he just likes to have a scrap, mate. And with the boxing game, sometimes you've got to fight these journeymen, make your way up the rankings, and then you'll get a high-level fight. He wants to go in and knock pony out of someone. Do you know what I mean? Simple.
You had a sparring little bit with him, didn't you? Fucking hell. Yeah.
Just before my BKB fight. Well, yeah. Probably about 4 or 5 weeks out, wasn't it?
Yeah.
It was a funny one because it was on a Friday. I was going to rest this day, and Josh texts me, and he's like, oh, Luke's back sparring.
Yeah.
He just had some trouble, I think, with police, and he's wanting to get back into it. Do you want to come down?
Yeah.
Do a bit of sparring. I'm like, I don't like turning it down, even though I'm like, I'll come down, thinking we'll just have a little bit of a move about
it. You see, that's a fighter's mentality. Yeah. Do you know what I mean? Like, straight away, like, lads like say, fuck, you know. And they're like, I've got to do it.
Exactly. So I thought, it'll just be a little move about, do each other a favour. And then he's there with groin guard on, getting Vaseline upon. Yeah. I said to Josh, I'm like, this is not the spar we're expecting, but let's move.
Pretending and phones ran.
Yeah. And then it was just a bit of a heavy spar.
Yeah, a lively one,
The good spars, though, the spars that you need. And sometimes, like days like that, when you spar out of your comfort zone, mate, it's just going to fucking add another tick.
I still took stuff out of the spar when we realised I was missing some pieces before my fight.
Are you out again, Ellis?
I ain't trained probably 3 or 4 months now, maybe a bit longer, but we're trying to get some glove boxing, some influencer boxing, something that's going to help the brand more than the bare knuckle stuff.
Do you know what, mate? That's a fucking great idea. That is such a good
idea. Times are changing, aren't they? I don't know what your views on it, but influencer boxing doesn't seem to be that bad of an idea. Some people hate it, some boxers hate it.
What do you think?
Exactly,
money?
Mate. It's money.
People slag it, mate, but you know. Obviously, I'm good mates with Tom Zanetti and he's trained with me for years. He's not training with me for these fights because the times he wants and stuff, I can't do. And he's a great lad and he's my pal. He has been for years. I've been all over with him, but it's like...
Have a word with him then and tell him to fight me on next show.
I'm telling you, I might be able to work that out. But it's like influencer boxing there, mate. Anything that's going to earn you a few quid... Right, what are you going to do? Get bare knuckle and get paid peanuts probably and get fucking smashed in face with bare knuckles or box someone influencer that you're probably going to chain tenfold and get a lot of dough. It's not rocket science, is it? I know I'd have lads in gym that slag it because in a way you've got to look at professional boxers and they have trained all their lives, amateur.
Yeah.
Amateur pro, they're getting up running and training and fucking what they have dedicated and sacrifices, I can understand and I can see it myself.
Tough for these people.
I totally agree.
Yeah.
But what's changing is that social media, people who are like the Conor McGregor effect where he's just won everybody over on internet. If these professional boxers that are coming up from amateurs and going to pro, if they adapt to what everyone else is doing that's doing it for themselves, like that are documenting everything and promoting themselves well, just like his influencers are, you'll get there faster.
Yeah, 100%.
We had Jodie Wilkinson on and we tried to have a word with her. She's really against it. Obviously, she's worked hard.
Yeah.
But if she just adapts to it, social media, start calling people out, start making a bit of a show of it.
It's how you sell yourself in it with that game. You know, it's how you sell yourself and there's big bucks involved. Like I say, you'll think, fucking hell, these lads are getting this done. I suppose it's just life and it's the situation you've been put in, innit? Do you know what I mean? And look at Tommy Fury, he's not going to be a...
What purse did he get there, do we know?
Tommy, I think he got 7 mil. And they were going to double it if he'd have fucking signed the contract.
Mate, see what I mean?
We had Amber O'Donnell on an OnlyFans model.
Yeah.
And she's in this tournament with Elbrook. And
the same tournament
that you win, it's 100 grand purse.
Fucking,
that's what women
and
as well.
And she's done no boxing, really, has she? Other than like boxing for fitness.
Is she fighting Elbrook?
No, she's fighting Emily Brooke, who's Elle's sister.
But they're in a tournament, so they're going to fight these.
What's she like, Emily Brooke, as a boxer?
Well, it's her first fight, so we don't really know.
I'm going to say, because Elle's had a few, hasn't she?
But Elle's good, mate. I was showing one of the lads this morning.
Amber with P and see if they can do something there.
Does she box under?
Well, she trains in Sheffield or Nottingham Way, somewhere like that. And she She fights under an ex-pro MMA fighter, and I recognise his name. I'll have to have a look on my phone after and show you.
Yeah. But she would at Warrington's gym doing sparring because it's all in it, Elbrook.
That's what I mean. It's massive, isn't it? It's everywhere. It's everywhere. It's in people's faces. And
I think you see the importance of that, though. I think you do a good job now of putting out content. We're doing the vlog stuff, you podcast scene. It's only going to grow your brand as well, isn't it?
That's it, mate. Like you say, like Ellis says himself, you're building a brand, aren't you? And whatever you can do to get your brand to the top, something you've got to do, haven't you?
Do you ever have a shortcut, innit?
Yeah, do you ever have an idea to package your knowledge and be able to sell it online? Is that the eventual play, or do you like in person just...
Do you know what? I do. I have got a little plan there with Alex Mavar, who's Progress Through Resilience is his media team, and we're doing tutorials on boxing. I watch a lot of tutorials, and there's some great tutorials, but there's some fucking dire ones as well, you know what I mean? And we've got a load of videos put together, and hopefully we're going to build a website and you'll be able to have tutorials online. And if you're overseas, you'll be able to have one-on-one tuition online.
Very nice.
So that's a goal that we've set.
The internet's making it forever scalable now. You can take your knowledge, package it and sell it 24/7.
It's mad, mate. It's mad what you can do now. There's such a big market for it all. It's great. And it's another goal, isn't it?
Who have you got? So we just spoke about your talented bare knuckle. You said Scott McHugh. Who are the gloved boxers we need to be looking out for that you've got?
Well, I'd say all the pros at the moment is Jack Bateson, who's going to make not even a big comeback, a setback, you know what I mean, that he's had, and just go on and win titles. Kobe McNamara, Michael Favera, Ishmael Davies and Zahid Hussain are the main pros in the gym at the moment. That are, you know, going to go on and do big, big things, set the boxing world alight, a lot of them.
I know you've been training a lot now, just I'm trying to get my nutrition back in order. You follow a strict diet, you were just quite flexible.
I fucking eat what I want when I want, really. Say if I'm going on holiday, I burn that many calories in a day. People don't realise if I'm giving these fighters 10, 12 rounds on pads and I'm taking private lessons, try to be enthusiastic. I'm always racing non-stop, so I've been doing a lot more weights, probably training weights 4 times a week and boxing 2x a week. It's just a mixture for me, you see, because I'm boxing all day. Sometimes I won't even train in my own gym.
Yeah, it's like to get out of it. No one talks to you.
A bit and I'll have a little munch about and stuff, and I trained here over there.
So I didn't know if you were like checking.
Weights weren't big enough.
I thought you got fucking day wrong. I'm like, for fuck's sake.
No, I've been on with a prep company and that's helped because my food's been there. But I try to eat as clean as I can when I can, but I don't like it.
You know, it's a big difference when you do eat clean in your...
Oh, your body, your mind, everything's unbelievable. But I'm 65% clean, best I can. You know what I mean? I do like odd fucking chips.
A question I've got for you, because it's how I feel sometimes. When I sort of got projected into business and had to start doing public speaking, my default mind, I always say this, is I'll probably quite introverted me. I won't necessarily like a big extroverted character.
Yeah.
You've got a big personality, a big character. Is that something that's always been there, or is that something you've really worked on to sort of be energised and...
I wouldn't say I've worked on it. I'd say I've been pushed into it a little bit because, just going back to my friend, when I had the gym on my own, I had to be front of house. Mm. I had to be front of house. I had to take classes full of 30, 40 people, do you know what I mean? 6 days a week.
You were just projected into
that. Boom. And then things were forced on it when, like, media teams have come. The more you do, it's like, the better you get. And you're just comfortable in your surroundings and... It's sort of like you just flow from there, you know.
Because when you say that with the drinking there, I've never really gone down that path with it. But me on an evening, if I've had a busy day of business and I'm podcasting and I'm like really giving a lot of energy, I just sometimes need to check out on a night. It's almost like fuck, burnt out completely.
Yeah, but I were that far in, I needed that to take me out of reality.
That was your release and then go.
Where now I can go home, sit back and think, oh, you know what I mean, and enjoy what I've done in the day and look forward to tomorrow and plan better, you know, so that's me there.
Have you ever toyed with any psychedelics?
Do you know what? Psychedelics haven't really been the one for me. Mm. I've had smudge in me here about a few times, do you know what I mean? But, God's honest truth, I would be interested to learn more about them. I know Holmes is... spoke to me about what he's done, and I've had a lot of people that have come off of drink and stuff and sort of found a bit more spiritual side of himself. I'm an open-minded person. I'd like to know a little bit more about them.
Mm. As we started speaking about that a bit more openly, I'm surprised how many people have done it, you know, whether it be DMT, mushrooms or whatever they're taking. Yeah, yeah. They've really tried to explore their own brain.
Yeah,
and
don't get me wrong, I've fucking rolled around Amsterdam on mushrooms before, but never never like
I'd like to see you in Amsterdam. I bet there's some mischief going on, eh?
Oh, fucking hell, not many.
Keep that one PG.
Yeah. So, obviously, you've been boxing, kickboxing from a young age. You started coaching and stuff. When did you get into the drink much? Obviously, if you were a sportsman growing up and you had this figure in the gym that were helping you, were you drinking at a young age, going out partying with the kids, or did it sort of creep up as you got a bit older?
Until about, I fought French champion when I was about 20, I think. And then, I was like a monk. Until when I was fighting and training, 13 till about 20-ish. Obviously, I wasn't drinking at fucking 30. Can I super tenants before school? But what do you call it? I lived and breathed the sport, and then I did start doing it recreationally with pals and stuff, and then I enjoyed it. But it was just a bit of fun on a weekend or every second week or once a month, and then I think grief had a big thing to do with it early in my life. And then I were all right. I did it in spurts and I wouldn't drink for 6 weeks and think I were all right. Listen, I love being round, lads. I love having a drink. I love having a crack. Messing about. I'm a people's person. I love that. But when they go home, I don't stop. Do you know what I mean? And that was the difference I had to realise. But yeah. I've had some good times.
A lot of people say that, though, don't they? I've noticed a lot of people who have been in some form of addiction there. These points where you can look back, where it was fun, and there were times where your friends and you open up, and
you've met some great people through it. And I love music, me.
Yeah,
I love house music.
The place to go in Leeds now? Then what's the venues?
Oh, I'm gonna have to say Playroom, which is obviously Tom's in it. It's all I train a lot of bar owners, obviously, but I think a lot. I don't know, mate. See now, I'm knocking on.
Is Fiverr still the place to be?
Fiverr, fucking hell.
I bet you've been in Penthouse a few times, haven't you?
I've been in Fiverr plenty of times, bouncing about. And I tell you what, I don't know if you've ever been, but me and my mates always have a crack. It don't matter what you look like. If you've got no shoes on, if you blitzed out of your head, boom, you're getting in Storm Rose's bar.
Yeah. Are you going to say Fiverr then? Because Fiverr used to be right strict. No, always been able to cue me like, fuck, am I going to get in?
Fiverr is still kind of strict.
Yeah. The thing is, it's like, I love music, and when Fiverr's got great music, and I like that sort of like Balearic House, Ibiza sort of style music. I like indie music as well. I'm into all sorts of music, but
I think I've seen you a couple of times at Viaduct as well.
Chase me. Chase me.
Have you been? I've managed to dodge this one, Ibiza party. Have you been out there?
Yeah, I've been at, I think I've been twice. Oh no, I've been three times to Ibiza. Yeah.
What's that like as an island?
It's nice. It's just, it's where you go to get melted, isn't it? You know, you just, it's a beautiful island. Obviously, I won't go to Party Central now. I'd like to go to a different part with Mrs. or whatever and actually see the island. But yeah, it's just, like you say, it's good music everywhere, good vibes, and time to get on it, innit?
We spoke to Christy yesterday, and I'm a big believer in this. I'm trying to teach Ellis this a little bit. How important is a good woman in your life? Is that key for you? Is that a massive importance?
By the way, he's fucking fully throwing me under the bus here because I've got a missus, so I don't know what
you're
saying.
No. What I'm saying is, what I'm trying to say is,
your missus is shit, get rid of her.
No, not like that. I need that anchor, me.
Yeah.
If I haven't got that anchor, there's a lot of distractions, there's a lot of...
They say, don't they, behind every great man is a massive set of tits. He's a great woman, and my missus, Erica, you know, I've nearly been with her 5 years. She's fucking... She's stuck by me, and she's. It's been hard because of how I've been and stuff like that. And but she's a great woman, and she's got her own business, and she's very, very screwed on and focused with her own life. She's got two kids as well, and you know, she's stuck by me, and how I am now, we've never been as good. Do you know what I mean? It's great, and like when you've got someone. The other day, she's like, I'd just been off at drink 11 weeks. She sent me a text saying, now, don't forget, I'm at my gym. I'm at the top. People come to me. I sit with me doing great. She just sent me a text saying, I'm proud of you.
Yeah,
you
know massive.
I was like, boom.
Yeah.
Wow. And I got like goosebumps. I went, fucking right. I'm on it. You know what I mean? Because I want to do her proud. I want to do myself proud of my family and just keep on what I'm on with now, because I believe Jim's going to go a different
It's way. Interesting you say that, because you're in that position of power. You're almost top of the, you know, the coach. You're the mentor to those boys.
Yeah.
You sometimes miss out on that little bit of mentorship yourself, because it's hard to, people will look at you and think, right, he's got all this in order, he's got all this set. You never really get that sort of time to be like, right, this is what I'm doing.
You're very clued up there, mate, because it is like that. And like I say, when I lost my mate, I lost that, and I lost him at a young age. So I had to grow up in a respect in what I had to do. But yeah, it's just like, we're lucky really, because we've got a good, like I say, family orientated gym, so everyone's got each other's back. You know, when I'm training them, I'm the trainer, simple as. When they're out of camp, I can be the friend, I can be the pal, and we, you know, we all get on.
Selfishly, what I'll ask, are you a UFC fan?
I like UFC because obviously I'm from a Thai boxing background and I've done a little bit of grappling and that, but I do like
Did you watch John Jones' comeback fight?
I didn't watch the whole fight. I've seen snippets and highlights of it.
What do you think to him being... I'm a believer that he's probably the best to ever do it. Is that a fair assessment, you think?
Yeah, definitely. He's every aspect of mixed martial arts he has covered. And like he picked on there, he sells himself. And even like being in trouble for fucking sniffing or whatever, people buy into it and they watch it and fucking, you know, him being a bit of a bad man.
I kind of like that bad man that he's being.
And it's like them people are sort of intrigued in him.
Yeah.
Because these people deep down think, oh, fucking hell, I've done that. Do you know what I mean?
And relatable.
And sometimes, like, obviously you've got to be super, super clean when you're an athlete, but it just brings more to the table, more fire. Any sort of press for him is going to, you know, build
him
up.
He has been through all sorts.
Do you know what's a little bit weird, though? I just thought then. Fair enough, he's not gone into bars punching old men like Conor McGregor
has.
When Conor McGregor gets outed for fucking cheating on his missus and sniffing cocaine and all that shit, all he gets is hammer. Whereas John Jones, he'll fucking fire a gun out of his car whilst he's sniffed up drinking beer in it. Yeah. Everyone likes it.
He's a king, isn't he?
That Gustafsson fight, they said he was sniffing cocaine 2 weeks out before the fight.
He said it himself. He had
a mindset behind it. Tell the story about what he said.
His reasoning was, I'm confident I can beat him. If I can beat him now, getting off me nut with fucking strippers 2 weeks before my fight, I just know I'm greatest anyway. So, but if he beats me, or if it's close.
He wanted a built-in reasoning.
So he's give himself an extra goal in his mind, hasn't he? Yeah. Do you know what I mean? He's fucking, he's mad because you do think mad stuff like that. I mean, it can be all different, you know, but...
I bet his benders are big as well, do you reckon? I reckon they're not a small little scoop. I bet
who, John Jones is?
Yeah, it's an 8-ball and it's fucking, let's go.
Oh, geez, that's a that's a proper slug.
Because one of his things, because I followed his story... He used to take these, you know, the boner pills you can buy from garages, these suspect ones that you find in, like, fucking random toilets.
That
one of his excuses, that he was just taking them religiously.
Really?
Yeah, because he got popped. Remember that?
What are you on about, blowies, to get you barred up?
He went buying Viagra. We were going to, like, in America, you go to these sort of petrol stations and they're just selling fucking boner pills in garage and he would just fucking taking them, I think.
Just a laugh?
Yeah.
Well, no, I think he wanted to fuck, didn't he? Like, but
I heard he had them Viagra fucking eye drops that didn't do out for him, just made him look at.
I'm not a big Bluey fan, but you are, aren't you?
Yeah. I'm not a big Bluey fan, but the line of work that I'm in, I've got to try and be like horny all the time, pretty much.
Fucking blood pressure felt real.
Yeah, that's what I said. He said he felt his heart flutter over there, so maybe stop taking them cunts.
I woke up and my heart was just a bit squeaky.
It's worse when you're having your cornflakes and double dropping.
I'm not that bad, like.
Yeah, but you're not taking the Viagra, you're taking the Cialis, aren't you?
Cialis.
But he microdosed it, it's never out of his system.
Yeah, really?
So he's ready at all times, mate, don't it?
Fucking hell, I ain't getting me tits out.
We'll close on this. I've been asking everyone who's been involved with the Ohms and Christie fight to shoot a promo. April 22nd, what can people expect? You've been in camp with him, obviously you're his coach. Shoot me something here, give me some motivation.
You can expect Anthony Ohms turning up, you know, with no stone unturned, and the best version of Anthony Ohms that you're going to see, whether it be a war or whether Anthony Ohms, you know, puts on a masterclass. So I'm not going any further than that. But you'll see the numero uno, the king of the bare knuckle that night, won't you?
Happy boys?
Yeah, I've just got one more thing to add on to that.
Yeah.
Are you going over to America with him if he beats him and goes and fights Lorenzo?
Fucking too,
right. They've announced that officially now.
Yeah. You might have to have a couple of beers to celebrate that one.
I'm getting straight back up.
I love that. Right.
Happy lads.
Thanks very much.
Are you ready for the fire? Look, we're firemen. Okay. We are firemen. The heat doesn't bother us. We live in the heat. We train in the heat.
Yeah,
it tells us that we're ready. We're at home. We're where we're supposed to be. Flames don't intimidate us. What do? We control the flame. We control them. We move the flame where we want to. And then we extinguish them.